geopolitics of Syrian conflict became more and more important. As you know, since yesterday, we have the Saudi Arabian initiative to establish anti-ISIS coalition with 34 countries, and Turkey is one of the countries which promised to be together. And this Syrian conflict is one of the maybe modern conflicts which will have not only regional implications, but has already global implications. Because everyone is nearly there. The West and the East, despite having the, in quotation, Islamic State, the countries are there. The Islamic countries are there. Russians are there. Chinese and Indians are there, but invisible, you cannot see them, but they support. And suddenly, this Syrian geopolitics became a global phenomenon, overshadowing the Palestinian-Israeli conflict, for example. Even the refugee crisis, which we are going to debate, is part of this problem, but not the cause, the reason of the problem. And what is more important, even the Kurds, which also part of this problem, are suffering more and more because Iran, Iraq, Syria, and Russia now build a big block. And I do not see that the Kurds will have the opportunity to establish an independent state. They missed the historic opportunity. From this perspective, the Turkish foreign policy in recent days to fight PKK is getting more and more stronger. The determination is much more than ever before. And what is more important, the PYD, the Kurdish group in Syria, fighting on the side of Russia, and definitely Russia is going to support more in future, but they will also be limited within the Syrian territory. They will not have any opportunity to establish a state. So, in other words, there is no Kurdish spring, or there is no Kurdish possibility to establish an independent state within the given condition. 3 years ago, most probably we could think in much different parameters. But today, with this new type of alliance, the Iranians in particular, they side now with Russia, and even in my country, Turkey and Iran, we have a conflict now. More and more the trade relations are getting tense, and this Turkish-Russian conflict will have also much more, I would say, wider implications on the bilateral as well as on regional field. We have published recently an article about the Syrian conflict from the very beginning until the said just crashing the Russian airplane by Turkish Air Force. So in this context, as somebody who is not only reading, teaching, but also discussing about the issue nationally and internationally, I can only say that the geopolitics of Syrian conflict will further occupy us, not only what is going on in the inside of the country, but also how, after the 1st of January, this new Syrian negotiations will take place. Since yesterday, as you know, the American Secretary of State, Mr. Kerry, is in Russia, and he was confirming to the Russians that the Americans and the Russians think similar in case of Syria. What it means they do not have any interest, in other words, to get Bechelesan out from the power. So they proposed a solution together with Bechelesan, which on the other hand does not comply with Turkish foreign policy, because from the very beginning Turkey was interested that Bashar al-Assad regime is out of power, and also the northern Iraqi Kurdish autonomous region, Barzani, in his area was the same idea. But to my understanding, both failed because the Americans and the Russians have already confirmed that they go to the future negotiations, to the presidential elections in Syria, together with Bashar al-Assad. The topics, actually, what we have to discuss more is, my expectation is actually, as in the article, in the publication, we said, we try to apply the chaos and order theory. So what it means, chaos and order? You have a problem which started after the Arab Spring, or together with the Arab Spring. Many Arab countries were affected. Egypt, Tunisia, Algeria, and Iraq, totally. We expected that this Arab Spring would bring more democracy, actually, but the result was today more chaos. The Middle East is not a stable region today, it is a chaotic region. Because when you look to the international cartoons or international articles, and you see how it is like a potpourri, if you want, of all these powers, global powers, regional powers, local powers, everyone is there. It's like a Christmas, I would say, market. You go there and you find everything: German weapons, American weapons, Russian weapons, Chinese weapons, Iranian weapons, all type of weapons you find there. And you find all type of fighters. Mediterranean, for example, which has been considered so many years as a peace sea, today is bombing, if you want, all the navies from France, Britain, America, Russia, Turkey. They are all there. I do not count, of course, the Israelis, despite it's very small, but they have also. So Mediterranean became really a hot sea. It is very possible that if there is a small fire, it can create a much bigger conflict. So everyone at the moment in the global scale talking about the third world, although we do not have officially the third world, but the discussions, the intellectual orientation is going to this direction. I don't know how it will continue more, but the fact is, I underline again, the Syrian conflict is at the same time a conflict between the secular forces among the Islamic countries and the secular forces of the Western world. And outside of the Western world, India, China, having different, I would say, religious understanding, philosophical understanding, but they are also interested, because as in the book tonight we have introduced, there is a state-like emergence, caliphate, or Islamic caliphate, or Islamic state, whatever you call, and these people also changed the geopolitical context. It is not a state, but it is an army. It is not warlord type like in Africa we have seen. It is just there, controlling certain resources, and none of the superpowers, in a sense of America, included, they were not able to get this group of ISIS away. Everywhere in the American political debate, as I said very last night we had a presidential debate among the Republicans candidates, and they started with this. Number one issue has been ISIS and how to defeat. They don't know whether Islam is an enemy, Islam is a friend, or this, how we have to deal with this Islamist. Donald Trump was saying something, many people reacted, but actually he's representing a certain amount of people who think like this. The politicians, ladies and gentlemen, represent a way of thinking of a certain group of the society. What Marine Le Pen is thinking in France is not so much different in this sense what Mr. Trump said. And the British Prime Minister today, he said he's stupid, he said nonsense, all this, perfect. But Britain is also there, in the Middle East, bombing together with the other forces, ISIS. Now, this geopolitical context, I think, of Syria is not only on resources now, but also how the Islam and the West will manage to live together. This is important. Yeah? So the West is not totally against Islam, and the Islamic people are not totally against the West. So it is not this polarization that either you are for me or you are against me. No, it is not the case. There are certain groups, certain way of mainstream thinking, which is saying, okay, we have to live together, we have to find new ways, but the radicals are a common problem. We have to find them. And this is, I would say, also the result of this refugee crisis. I think since Bosnian war in the 90s, we have now more than 7 million people, which makes around 25-27% of the society of Syria. They are living outside of the mainland. They live in Turkey, in Lebanon, and in Jordan. I visited certain camps in all these three countries. And I know what I'm talking about. It's very difficult, it's very inhuman what we experience, but this is the fact. The people are there. And this refugee crisis created for Europe a big problem. Europe is not anymore the same Europe as it was the case in May 2015. And the wave of the refugees started to go to European direction. First via Italy, then via Greece. Of course, Turkey is used as a bridge. And air, seaway, and railway, and also by buses. In all this summer, we all watch the pictures, how the people are running there with their all their children, all their wives, and elderly and young people, it doesn't matter. We saw, for example, how Hungary was building now the new walls in the heart of Europe, how a Cameroon was trying to stop this family, a Syrian family, with a child, and this family became so well known that Ronaldo from Portugal is now supporting this family financially. And we have at the same time countries like Austria, like Germany, they have been always against the refugees. Germany, for example, was saying that Germany is not a country of immigrants. Deutschland ist kein Einwanderungsland. This is that Germany is not a migration country, immigration country. In the entire 80s and 90s, it was the German foreign policy paradigm. And now they got 1 million people. 1 million. So, and they stopped. They stopped today. So, why it is important? Because this refugee movement is also the result of the Syrian conflict. We have radical Islam, we have social calamity, social drama, refugees, and the third question is, we don't know how to solve it. I visited in all this month several countries. Lastly, in Denmark, I saw how the people try to adjust themselves to the new conditions. In Germany, every night the people organize perfectly to provide food and shelter to those people because the winter is coming. And Austrians and the Germans, I underline this, suddenly they became the most hospitable nations in Europe for the refugees. The public work or the public diplomacy is really unique. Even if the Canadians, with their new prime minister, Mr. Trudeau, when they got a couple of thousand refugees, they made such a theater, if you want, such a show. Even they organized a young children choir to sing a song from the 16th, 17th century of the Arabs, so that they welcomed them. Okay, perfect. But what type of people are taken by the Western countries? Australia, New Zealand, Canada, America. Americans are also getting 25,000. You know what type of people? They make a choice, a la carte choice. They get the best educated people who can read, write, speak language, or belonging to a certain category of this society, which is accepting without asking anything for this. It is Turkey. We have 2.2 million people officially as refugees in Turkey. 60,000 of them already born in Turkey. 50% of the people do not write and read. 50%. We have only 16% of the people who went to elementary school. Only 8% people are graduates from the universities. We reverse the picture. The entire countries of European continent, I think including Portugal, tomorrow, the first 24 people will come. Please control, is there any one of them who is illiterate? I can guarantee you it is not. It's not. I can guarantee you. Check it if they are journalists. Why I'm telling this? Because the more the distance is, the more the people have to prove certain qualifications and papers. And we're here to the border, 910 kilometers. Of course, Turkey, from the very beginning, could not say, don't come. Because the house is burning, the people are running out, and you have to accept the people. But we have underestimated the numbers. It is the critic of the Turkish government. I criticize this here in Japan, in Denmark, in America, everywhere. I repeat it here. The Turkish problem was the miscalculation of the Syrian case, miscalculation of the refugees, and also the overextension of the Turkish self-confidence. I quote the Turkish Prime Minister, who was foreign minister at that time. He said, Professor Ahmet Davutoğlu, he said, we accept people, they are our brothers, Muslims, okay, they may come. The first 3 weeks, we have, actually, the first group of the people have been 614 people who arrived to the Turkish border. The second one, next day, we had another 600, then 1,000, 2,000. Turkey was building camps, really, like five-star Hilton hotels, with all the school children, etc. Perfect. But the red line was 40,000. Turkey would accept 40,000 people, no problem. Then the wave is so big, like a tsunami. It is like a small wave I saw yesterday on the river. But the 20 kilometer distance from here, in Kashkai, the waves are very big. In Porto, much bigger. So we got the wave of people coming in thousands of children, young, elderly, educated, less educated, terrorists, everyone. And this changed, the Syrian conflict changed the Turkish society. We dispersed those people in 81 cities. In Istanbul alone, in Istanbul, we have 450,000 registered, 450,000 registered Syrian refugees. So, it is, imagine, half of Lisbon, more or less, or one-third of Lisbon, refugees, overnight. And we, Turkey paid $9 billion until now for the education, healthcare, shelter of this. And another mistake of the Turkish government was, I criticize this also very strongly, and all these people who work in UNHCR or on refugee issues, Turkish Prime Minister and President just wanted to show the Turkish hospitality to the entire world, they accept them, and they said, we do not accept any foreign aid. It was the second mistake, miscalculation one. The second one, if you say, no, I don't need any foreign help, I'm rich, I can deal with the problem. And we, the Turkish payers, we pay $9 billion. That the European Union is providing 3 billion euro is just a peanut. It does not solve the problem, but it will bring Turkey more to the European Union to have more re-energized relations, if you want. One of the former German ministers and European Union Commissar, Günther Verheugen, stated today, he said that Turkey and the European Union now negotiate and started to have relations. That does not mean that Turkey is joining the European Union. It is not the case. And I, belonging to Brave School of International Relations, I think in the same way. Therefore, Ms. Angela Merkel, the German Chancellor, she said, Turkey is still the key country for the Syrian refugee crisis. I agree with this. This is true. Turkey is having this policy of responsibility. And just last week, the Turkish Prime Minister was saying they should come more. We can accept, we can, if you want, get all those people who want to come to Turkey, we can say, we cannot say no, don't come. It is more ethical, it is more philosophical approach than, rather than a realpolitik approach. But what happened now, Turkey came with a new suggestion. Turkey says we should create a safe haven, a certain corridor in Syria where for every person with this $9 billion, actually, we can build new houses, new apartments. We can do this. Probably, when the negotiations start in January 1st, probably this will be one of the most important issues to rebuild Syria. But for this, of course, first of all, the threat of ISIS has to be abolished. So if ISIS is there, it is dangerous. We cannot expect that the people are going back if there is a state-like organization which is endangering the entire structure. I think this Syrian conflict or the geopolitics of Syrian conflict is teaching us also how this type of big ideas to transfer democracy to other countries is not always so easy. So to fair democracy to the Middle East is an entertainment, but not a fact of matter. What happened? In the 90s, we had in Central and Eastern European countries this transformation from a totalitarian regime to democracy successfully done. But it is not the case in the Middle East. So it was the American mistake. They thought that they can create Lithuania, Estonia, Latvia, or Poland in the Middle East. It is not. Middle East is another chapter. Graham Fuller, the American Middle East expert, who has written with World Without Islam, he was writing many other publications about the moderate Islam. First time, the term moderate Islam emerged in 1991 when he was publishing the book with Ian Lesser with the title Democracy Trap. Democracy Trap means that those countries who do not have any smartest democratic tradition, that they can not be democratized, as Bali Nasser, the advisor to American President Barack Obama, Iranian origin, professor of science, is very instrumental in this things. He said, he has written a book, Democracy Without Democracy. He thinks, in the Middle East, if you do not have a middle class, you cannot create a democracy. All the democratic countries have middle class. Those who pay taxes, who create something, who produce, and then have the right, of course, criticize the political system. Democracy is not the best, of course, as Winston Churchill used to say, it is the second best, because the best system has not been created yet. But this democratic traditions, they need a certain infrastructure. I think in the book of Henry Kissinger, the World Orders, there is a specific chapter concerning the Islamic world. And I'm made critics of Islam, and very careful in order to prevent any misunderstanding. Islam is a big civilization. But Islam does not provide in the last 200 years anything for the further civilizational developments. When you look to the technology, when you look to science, just UNDP report says in 1 year the books published in Spain, it is more than the entire Islamic countries. One country. It means the social sciences, the debate, the discussion, the debate that the regimes get certain critics. Many Arab countries, many Islamic countries are more radical or getting more radical because they do not have the debate or discussion. If you cannot criticize the president, if you cannot criticize the leader, how can you create a room, a space of understanding? Even the Russians are more democratic in this sense. Putin is very strong, etc. You can criticize whatsoever, but they go to the elections and they have the opposition and they make something. In the Islamic world, 57 countries, Turkey is one of them, 57 countries do not produce a couple of members of the European Union. Don't talk about these natural resources that these Islamic countries possess. It is another thing. The question is, and I make here an intellectual challenge for the long run, what type of students, what type of persons, citizens, produce the Islamic world, which is in competition with the Western Chinese even African and non-Islamic world. The Muslims are in the world 1.5 billion people. We are 7 billion in the world. So it makes around 22-23%. And when you look, unfortunately, once again, that the Islam from the 7th to the 11th century, it was very progressive. The Islamic contributions to the world technology, world science has been great. It was Bernard Ruiz, actually, who has written a wonderful book with the title What Went Wrong? It means, why Islam started to lose from the 17th century on, that the Western world, within the 350 years, could surpass the entire Islamic world, and in science, technology, culture, etc., achieve a civilizational level that our founder, Kemal Atatürk, was saying that Turkey has to reach the contemporary level of civilization. This is the parameter of the modern Turkish Republic. It does not say we want to reach the contemporary level of Islamic State. Because all Islamic states have been, in worse case than Turkey. Now, this is the, another philosophical debate. I think it is important. How, in the coming decades, in the next 10 to 20 years, with those big projects like Silk Road, with this project, expansion of the European Union. I mean, European Union has already 15 million Muslims, and now it is already 17 million with all these refugees. And this European Islam is also another challenge for the entire Western civilization, because you have to find a way to live together. This different cultural and religious background, how the institutions which we have at the moment will compete with these challenges of these cultural and religious differences? Do we have these institutions? Do we have intellectual preparedness for this? Question mark. Niall Ferguson was publishing another wonderful book with the title Decline of the West. Is not talking about like World War I and afterwards, that the European countries have been starting to fight with each other, but he was publishing another subsequent book with the title Civilization. Such a book, around 650 pages. In this book, he is trying to explain that the Western world is population-wise, is getting down, European continent, but the knowledge is clear. Power, knowledge is power. The technology, the science, it was like Bernard Ruiz in his memoirs, when the biography about his personal biography was published, he said, I was always surprised to see how so many people come to learn the Arab culture, Islamic cultures, to London School of Economics or to London University. His father was saying, I have difficulties to understand. They come from Islamic countries and they study here about Islam. It's exactly like my dear friend from Congo, the Republic of Congo, just recently in Italy said to me, he said, you see, I learned about my country's history in Hamburg more than in my country. Because in Hamburg, at the university, there is African studies, and they have all the Chinese, ladies and gentlemen, at the moment are making big progress. And Niall Ferguson says, what the Chinese are doing is cheating. They do not create technology. What they do is taking they are just taking the copy from the West, in Shanghai. I mean, in Shanghai, you go to the street, it's like London. The difference is, the number of the Chinese are more than in London. It is exactly like London. These streets where you make shopping, or eat pizza or I don't know, drink something. But the question is, and this is the biggest problem of the Chinese, if they want to rule the world in the 21st century, you have to create your own technology, your own science. I teach to my students this difference. We have friends from several countries, also some Turkish students here. I tell to my students in Turkey, I say, you do not learn for the others. You have to learn for yourself. Cheating is just helping you to pass the class. And you can. It is a temporary solution. But if you do not make the knowledge as part of your body, if it does not belong to you, you will always lose against those people who work. We call it academic self-discipline. So the strength of the Western world is that the students, the people, have this self-academic discipline from the kindergarten. Whereas in the Middle East and in the Islamic world, I make proportional statement, it is not so important. Important is that you pass the class and you lose. China is trying now to prevent this. They try to educate the people, and this is, I can tell you, they learn really good everywhere in the world, including in Turkey. And they have a new philosophy, because they have an idea. They want to be one of the leading powers. Now, the competition is between Eastern country, between China and the Western countries. Professor Wu from Bonn University has published 150 pages book about why China is just in the center of the globe and why China has no intentions at all to be in competition with the West. The main argument is we just want to be also like the European countries. We want to be rich, we want to have a good way of life, welfare system. Why you consider us as an enemy, as a potential, not rival, enemy, if we want to be stronger and richer? Because we are not Chinese? Oh. Because we are not Chinese, we could have difficulties to understand this. But if you make the empathy and put yourself into the position of a Chinese intellectual, then you would understand much better. So, the Syrian, I would say, geopolitical and geoeconomic context will teach us one. The world is not anymore the same as it used to be. The generations coming here from now, they will face much more harder challenges than we had in the Cold War years. In Cold War conditions, it was perfect. You have two sides, you know the limits, you have the number of weapons, you have the limitations to travel, limitations of reading, etc. It was much more stable. But now, it is not stable. We are confused intellectually. We have chaotic order. The institutions of 1945, it means the world order which we created after 1945 do not comply anymore the expectations not only of the people but also of the states. And now there will be much more stronger reactions. It will be social reactions, it will be economic reactions, and my question would be, what type of political leadership do we have? Do we provide political leadership that they can challenge this type of future problems? Globalization is definitely the fact. And I finish with this book publication. I would suggest, please, to read. The students should read this book anyway. If you don't do anything, read this book. This is the book by Moises Naim. He is the former Venezuelan Minister for Infrastructure. He is now in the Brookings Institution in Washington, D.C. In September 2013, he published this book. Maybe you read it in the newspapers this year, Mr. Zuckerberg from Facebook. He is reading the book. He said in January this year, it will be the first book which I'm going to read. He has read already. Ben Zuckerberg, please this book, please read too. This is the title, The End of Power. The End of Power. How the power is changing the hands. How the power is changing. How the individuals now getting more and more stronger. And how the globalization is making us to face the problems never ever before. We have mental revolution, we have more revolution, we have digital revolution. And last sentence really now, as I do it here, I'm here talking to you and we realize, Ricardo, the brain circulation is like money circulation. You have dollars and you have pounds, wherever you go, you get your credit card and you pay. What we do here is also the brain circulation. I'm here speaking to you, giving you my ideas, and I will go back to my home country. But we have the opportunity to travel all over the world. We are not taking brain drain, not going somewhere and staying there. No, no, it's not anymore. We don't need this. We have Facebook, Twitter, and all this. Now, this brain circulation is also the success of Autonoma, Autonoma from Lisboa, that I'm here and circulating you my views, my ideas. And if I'm a little bit helpful for you to contribute for your further enlightenment, I would be very happy. The Chinese start always this. They never say, I'm so good, etc. No, no, no. They say, please enlighten us. If I have done a little bit light into your hands, not like this very big lights, but even if it is a small life, I would be very happy. And thank you for your great interest, Nobel's Fair, at that time of the night.